Let's start with the year Stanford. I visited here years ago, and it's been a very long time since I came here. So yeah, my name is Katie Malmsteen. I'm a nurse practitioner.
My profession.
But my expertise recently has shifted towards telemedicine, actually using technology in medicine, including what I would say, not necessarily just telehealth, but, you know, telemonitoring, and we'll talk about a lot of different kinds of modalities of care that are being utilized right now in our healthcare system. For those of you who are in the Philippines, for anything. Money. Who's going to pay for this? limit. They're the one who provide you the information. It's like a one direction kind of a thing. The eccentric movement is talking about moving the direction the other way around. The patient will stay at home. They will be getting care on its own time when it's comfortable for them. They will be the one to provide the information about the care and also be the one to participate in the care as part of, you know, the decision making when it comes to how they're going to be cared for. So this is what telehealth, you know, is on the rise, and you may have seen it or not, but there's a big movement towards utilization of what we call telehealth or telephonic visits, video visits. Some of you may be wearing a Fitbit watch or any kind of health watch on your wrist. These are all part of the telemedicine movement to allow patients to interact with their providers in a different kind of manner. And some of the goals of telehealth in development, the reason why it's being developed, have a lot to do with the patient-centric movement. It's providing care for patients at their own return. So it has to be accessible. It means that I can do it from my office, from my home, from my cell phone, while I'm visiting my grandma in a different country. Capable, it means to be that it needs to be integrated with your health information, right? So we want every telehealth program to be able to tap into your current health information and vital signs. Affordable is extremely important. It needs to be something that you can afford. If I'm going to ask you for $200 a visit over the internet versus $30 a visit over the internet, you're most likely to be using the $30 visit. Transform the patient experience. So currently, the patient experience is very negative when it comes to health. People do not experience good health most of the time because they have to sit in the doctor's office for many hours. Then they have to drive 20 or 30 miles to get there. They may not even enjoy, you know, the parking situation. So obviously, you know, the patient experience is very negative. Telehealth can transform the patient experience. You can be sitting on your couch drinking, you know, your best coffee and wait for your doctor to call you at home without having to ever leave the home or without having to deal with all of the hassles. So obviously, when I can do that, I can transform your experience with healthcare. We also could then be able to manage populations much better. So if I want to take care of a whole population of diabetic patients or a whole population of COPD patients or other kind of chronically ill patients, I can actually do that better through telehealth because I can reach a larger number of patients very quickly versus having to have everybody come to see me as one provider. So it does allow me to do much more as a provider and provide better population health for my population of patients that I care for. Patient expectations are changing. I mean, you guys are the next generations. I know you guys don't want to go sitting in a doctor's office or lay in a hospital bed. You guys want kids to come to you versus you have to come to them. So you are the generation, you are the consumers who are changing how healthcare is being provided. And a lot of people, you know, will go on to Google or to the internet before they even go to a doctor these days. They will try to self-manage their disease or self-manage their symptoms. That's also part of the expectation that has definitely changed for our population, right? So our parents did not do that. They just went to the doctor, he told them what to do, and they listened. We don't do that. We don't listen exactly to everything that everybody's saying. And then, of course, our healthcare providers are burned out, and they want a different way of working. So if you do telemedicine, if you're a telemedicine provider, you may be able to provide care from home. We have physicians who work on golf courses and take patient calls while they're on the golf course. They are traveling and being able to still care for the patient. So, you know, it changes the fact that you have to sit in an office from 9 to 5 as a provider and care for patients with that. So, Kaiser, who is the leading, healthcare providers right now in telehealth, Kaiser has put it to them that 50% of their medicine will be done by telemedicine by 2020. That's kind of like the Kaiser goal, if you may. I don't know how much of that is happening right now, but I can tell you that 50% of the physicians' schedules are telephone visits and video visits. So they did a big survey in 2012, according to 2014, asking patients what are the top 10 things that are important to them in health. And these are the results. I don't have to read them to you, but if you look at some of the interesting, or the number one thing that everybody wants is access to care. I don't want to wait 3 months to see my doctors. I don't want to wait 2 months to see my cardiologist. I want to be able to see people when I need them, as I need them, right away. That is not a surprise for anybody. I think if anything, that people want to feel like, first of all, that they're people, that they're being cared for individually, that they're just not a number that is waiting in a waiting room to be called, that they have an increased understanding of their options, and that's something that we hear over and over from patients. I don't understand my options. If I have been diagnosed, God forbid, with terminally ill disease, cancer, for example, patients are not given many options. They're given the option that the insurance pays for, whereas they want the option that maybe the insurance does not pay for. They want all the options to be given to them. The problem for the providers on that side is if I sit with you in a room, I need to spend a good couple of hours to go over all of the options with you, and I only have 15 minutes schedule. So the likelihood of you getting all the options available for your care are reduced quite a bit. People want less medication. They don't want to be prescribed multi-medication for everything. They don't want every time that they go to the doctor to be given a new prescription. They want the option to have different kind of, you know, medication or different kind of health. And then security and trust, and that's something that we see everywhere these days. People can, you know, get everything. People stealing people's medical information, medical insurance. That is definitely a big concern for a lot of health companies, and definitely also for their insurers. And I'll stop there for a second. Does anybody have any questions or anything that you want to bring up? Good. Okay. Well, one of the things that you see a lot of, and many of you maybe actually have them on the list already, is medical wearable devices. And we've seen a huge increase in medical wearable devices that are coming out to the market almost on the daily. Now, here in Palo Alto, you guys are probably in the midst of all this. Stanford University itself has lots of investment into medical devices and have developed quite a few of them, in fact, what we call wearables. And so, the idea of all wearables, whether one way or the other, is to provide medical information about the patient, whether it's to transmit their heart rate or the blood pressure or the sugar readings or any other medical information. And then that information is being stored forward, hopefully to a medical provider, but sometimes just stay within your own app. So if you guys have one of those Fitbit apps or any other app, you know, you're doing the steps, you're the only one who has that information. You may or may not want to share that with your doctor. One of the problems that are coming up now with all of those devices is that there's a safety issue to them. Those devices can be hacked, actually, so you know anybody can hack it to your iPhone or to your cell phone. The same thing is they can be hacked into pacemakers and insulin pumps and everything else. So as we're starting to see more and more of those devices being developed, one of the things that the big concern that we're starting to see in the market is that how do we secure the information within the device and then how is it being transmitted to somebody else. Another problem that's happening is that we're collecting and collecting and collecting data, but there is nobody who's going to use it or reveal it or do anything with it. So if you send all of your steps to your doctor, he'll say, oh, great, you did a lot of steps, but it's not going to change medical management necessarily, or use the visibility with you. One thing that keeps on coming up quite a bit is which government agency is responsible for all, for all of the data that the wearable devices are producing, but also to the actual production security and safety of those devices. Currently, there is a lot of argument with who's the one who's supposed to be looking after that? Is it the federal government? Is it the state or individual? Who is the one who's going to be checking for the security? So because of that, there's currently very little start mechanism in place for any kind of malware on these devices, which also will create problems probably more in the future. Some of the challenges that we see in developing telehealth, because, you know, a lot of people will say, well, it makes a lot of sense. Let's just do it. What's so hard in, you know, having doctors online or doctors on the phone or having wearable devices set up to a doctor? Why is it so difficult? Well, there's a lot of challenges in telehealth, some of them that are more real than others. But the big one of them is low to adopt physicians. Our physicians are not exactly, you know, jumping on this to take this on as a next generation thing. They're not necessarily ready to take on different kinds of medicine, patient-centric medicine. Some physicians are worried that this is diminish their way they are practicing, diminish their view on the patient care, and some of them are truly just never been trained in telemedicine, so they're not comfortable providing that kind of care. So, and of course the system, the business model that we have right now in medicine, the fee-for-service, does not really allow us to bill patients over the internet. Yeah, I know a lot of these, but there's not many insurance companies who will reimburse physicians for telemedicine consults or for telemonitoring or for using wearable devices. So if our health insurance does not pay for it, the likelihood of us to adopt it is obviously being quite reduced because somebody needs to pay the bill, as we said originally. And currently there's nobody who can do that. Security, for example, there is, I can tell you that the NIH actually spoke about 12,000 security breaches to the system. And, you know, in about 12-day period, we know that there is a lot of security and cyber attacks on our healthcare system constantly. And that's another reason why telehealth is really, you know, really stopping.
Yes, I had a question about, you know,
so the answer to that is yes, Medicare and Medi-Cal charge reimbursement for telehealth, mostly in rural communities, because that's just the only way of getting help in these areas. But in the urban communities, it's very hard to get reimbursed for telehealth. So right here, for example, if we were, let's say Kaiser, for example, if Kaiser wanted to provide telehealth all the way into Santa Rosa and up into, you know, the counties up there, that shouldn't be a problem because they are zoned as rural communities. And rural communities don't even allow for some payment. By the way, that payment is quite low. Let me give you an example. So if you do just a virtual care for a patient on just, you know, day-to-day care for a patient in the rural community, you get $24 to $48, which, you know, doctors are a little bit frowning upon in this comes to that, right? But So the reimbursement, if there is reimbursement for local communities, that's one thing, but that reimbursement is still quite low, actually. Measuring clinical outcomes is a very big problem that we're in with telehealth. We're going to all provide, again, care in silos. How do we know that our medical outcomes are actually good, and how will we measure it, and who will be the one to measure that and make sure that we keep our eye here on the clinical goals for those patients, the population that we care for? And then, of course, the quality of care. One of the reasons why a lot of the medical boards are kind of concerned about telehealth is if they're going to allow physicians to move from state to state, who's going to govern the quality of care that those providers are providing in a different state? So these kind of questions have not been answered. And the big challenges within our system to the adoption of telehealth. Of course, another thing that we worry about, I can tell you, for example, for Kaiser is a great example. Kaiser started a system by which patients can email their provider directly. Well, guess what happened? There's a supply driven demand. The physicians are getting hundreds and hundreds of emails from the patients which they could not answer in a timely manner. So then the system had to invent something for them, which was a nurse who's going to answer the physician's email, and then they cannot answer everything. They will stipend that to the physician, and the physician will sometimes when we open the floodgates, we're not necessarily able to actually control the kind of amount of patients that we're going to be getting or the amount of control that we're going to have on the demand on our system. Another challenge is the determination of strategic focus. So when we start telehealth, we want to say, okay, let's do that for everybody. Are we going to do it for all our patients? 13 million patients at times, so we do it to everybody. Should we do it only for certain populations? Who should be getting it first? And then, you know, other issues is that workflow design is a big issue with internal medicine. If I'm going to have a physician who sees patients in a clinic, then some of his appointments are going to be via video. So how does that work? Does he walk into a patient room, then he stops and goes to get the video, and then he comes back into a patient room, sends him for the AMAs and the back office stuff? You know, there's a lot of workflow design that has to be challenged every time that we start a telemedicine. For companies who have put a lot of money into the development of those tools, they find very quickly that they are investing money not knowing what the return on their investment is going to be, whether or not they're even going to have return on investment. And that's very difficult for companies who want to invest in telehealth, not knowing exactly if they're A, going to be successful, and B, are they going to get their money back. I'm not going to talk about the implementation because this is not where this group focuses, but I do want to talk about we should be careful what we wish for. So we all run towards technology. We want more technology, more and more and more of it. We want more wearables. We want more devices and telehealth and all of that. But then what happens is we have a lot of consumer development devices. In fact, right now in our market, we are totally saturated. I know that you guys will know this, but there's about maybe 1,500 different wearable devices that are available for purchase on a daily basis. And people are now getting confused about which one will be good, and which one will really get my heart rate, and which one is accurate, right? So there's a lot of consumer excitement. Here in Palo Alto, in your area here, there has been development over development of medical devices and platforms and all kind of apps that are coming up in healthcare, and there's a lot of enthusiasm around, you know, getting this up and running, so there's a lot of investment that you guys are seeing into this. The problem with all of that is that a lot of people are promising a lot of different things, but they cannot really actually deliver on. So we can promise somebody that we can control the blood sugar with this wonderful rock that we're going to put in them. The reality is that we can't not control everything about the patient, so I may promise you something as a consumer, but I may not be able to deliver on it, which is another reason why, you know, we are moving very much into the ability to touch care. How do we judge people's care? Is it by cost? Is it by the accessibility? Is it by the quality of the care that they get? And so as we are moving towards this development, technology, we also need to kind of step back and say, are we ready for this? And can we actually judge clearly what it is that we are developing to the system and how people are going to be in the future reacting with their providers, you know, having all of this technology available to them. And then the big one, guys, is obviously always going to be security, malware, viruses. The ability to secure systems like this are going to be getting more and more challenging. And we see a lot of security breaches already happening in very big healthcare systems as well. So I'm just going to finish up with this one last slide before I go off to questions, but what are the next steps to our innovation process? There is, you know, any kind of innovation should be there to solve our healthcare problems, not to augment them. Currently, there is a lot of solutions in the market that are not necessarily solving our costly healthcare system. And so I really hope that whatever innovation comes in the future, if you guys are the innovators in the room, think about how to make our healthcare system much simpler, less, you know, complex, and innovation should really just try and help some of our problems. This needs to be longer and informative and educative. So if we're going to develop are we going to be able to give quality informative care to our patients in 5 minutes versus 15 minutes in the clinic? Are we moving towards that kind of innovation? That could be a little bit, you know, challenging. How are we going to build trust with our patients if we see them on the internet? Trust building is very big. A lot of people use the touch and do need to feel that they're trusted by the provider. Trust building is going to be a big hurdle in the future. We want technology to be safe, predictable, and we want it to be collaborative, so that we can talk to a lot of different providers all at the same time and with our patients. And we really want to make sure that everything that we develop in the innovative space with telehealth or in health in general is actually cost effective and not increasing the cost of a very costly healthcare system already. That we are doing it not for profit, but we're doing it for cost reduction. And then, of course, that anything that we develop always keeps the patient in the center and keeps the patient in mind of what is that going to help or do with the patient. That will be an extremely important feature, next step of innovation if we're going to continue the centric movement of patient care. So this is my little talk, and I will be open to questions or remarks from anyone in the room. Thank you.
Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
I really appreciate your very educated performance in the environment. I have a couple of simple questions. Based on all your experience and having consulted me on things like what is the most common mistake that they make that leads them to a failure of their
system? Actually, you know, this is a great question. I skipped this slide because it wasn't about implementation, but everybody who I know who failed in telehealth or people that I have are not going through the process. They refuse to assess the real problem and do a good assessment of the healthcare system readiness for telehealth. The provider's readiness for telehealth, the system's readiness for telehealth, legal and compliance readiness, patient's readiness. A lot of people actually start telehealth programs or develop platforms without actually ever speaking to the patient. These are the kind of mistakes that I see the most common, and when that happens, they will just jump directly to implementation. So a lot of people start right here, and they miss all of those steps here. And that is the reason why they almost always fail, because they have missed all of this great preparation work and they just move directly into let's just do this kind of thing.
And the other question that I have for you is, you said that physicians, they can meet their problems in their ways. And you know that, and we talk about this extensively. And on the other hand, patients are very open to innovation and different ways. How do you foresee or how do you advise new companies or new entrepreneurs going into the telemedicine arena? Being successful in spite of that, is it by utilizing more the workforce of nurses or other healthcare alliance versus physicians, or how do you see that?
I think it's a matter of, it's system by system, definitely. But one of the things I think that I found very successful is to find physicians, physician champions. Physicians who are young and hip and are into it and would love to try this out. And usually in any system, you will find physicians champions, right? People who are just gung-ho on technology and medicine and try to do the things. And usually what we do is that we do the assessment phase, we will find those people, whether they're nurses, nurse practitioners, physician extenders, or physicians, talking about how well he does with his patient in telemedicine. And other physicians hear that and they're like, oh, you know, there's this socialization into telemedicine that happens that way. But that's part of a very good assessment plan and really understanding who are your providers and how much are they willing to take risk within their own practice. I believe that we're going to see more and more of that. So that socialization is kind of starting to happen because people start to hear about telemedicine over and over. And it's happening just, it's slow compared to, for example, nurses who will be willing to take on telemedicine anytime because in their practice, they're a little bit more liberal in their thinking. So that's my trick, is to find those new champions within the system who are willing to, like, give this out of life. And that's what I'm doing right now. So right now I'm with DaVita Healthcare, and you know, we do have physicians who are a little bit resilient. We did find a lot of physician champions who were very excited to start telemedicine and try different things, and we do have programs that are running just due to their enthusiasm. So I believe this can be done, just much slower than what we would want it to be. Yes?
Go ahead. I guess it just seems so interesting as you're speaking about there's so many solution-oriented groups trying to develop things, and because capital is so cheap right now, there's just so much of it. Like, hey, why not just like start my startup? I guess my question is, as long as that continues, whose responsibility is it? Do you think it's the responsibility of the Stanford or like the CMC to sort of say, look, we just don't want any more of this? I mean, how can you kind of force these groups trying to innovate to start on the assess, establish, define stage? Do they have a responsibility to do it? And if so, how do they go about doing so?
I have to say, this is an excellent question, and I don't know if anybody can hear, but what really you were talking about is how do you stop, you know, too much innovation or like over innovation, which is pretty much what's happening right now. We are in a state of over innovation, for sure. There's just too much going on. In fact, every day you often, you know, if you're somebody like me who kind of consumes this kind of healthcare news, every day you will hear about a new company, a new funding, a new technology. How do you do that? You talk about it as much as you can. The reason I'm here today or, you know, when I go to conferences or speaking conferences to educate people about this process. So I'm trying to say, this is not just junkies who are spending, you know, I mean, there are companies that probably spend about $1 million selling in telemedicine. Altogether, in 2016, there were 150 telehealth companies that perished. That's millions of dollars that have gone into the trust, millions and millions of dollars. So the idea is to educate people who go into it, if they ask for your advice, to say, hey, stop for a minute, why are you doing this? How is that going to be valuable? Who's going to be using this device? How are they going to be using this device? And then really do take them through this assessment and let them think through the process of what am I developing and if I'm developing that, is that really going to be helpful to patients in the future? And hope that they listen, but a lot of it is driven by capital, like you said, and unfortunately we live in a capitalist country and people want to invest, so it's their money, unfortunately. Yeah.
Please.
Thank you. Supervisory going on in them, but the mid-level provider is driven. The biggest one, of course, is the VA hospital. The VA hospital So, yeah.
Do you think that's based on cost? Because it's more cost efficient.
It's cost effective, but it also seems to be the people that was easier for them to mobilize in that direction. It was almost, I think it comes from both sides. It comes from the cost side, but also, obviously, for people who are willing to try things, it was easier for them to mobilize for them, even
Yeah, so this class is being streamed to the Philippines, and we have a question from them. So what potential challenges and opportunities for telehealth would you see more of in an environment like the Philippines where there are relatively few telehealth companies?
Well, in the Philippines or in Asia, first of all, the healthcare systems there are much more lenient than the healthcare systems we have here. They can actually start programs in rural communities with this know-how much easier than we can here. So I think that for the Philippines, there are huge opportunities to start looking into providing care to the indigents in a different kind of way, because unfortunately, you know, it's a fee-for-service, but more cash-for-service in the Philippines. You go to the hospital, you have to pay to be there. So patients who can't do that are probably pretty much left without. This is an opportunity for the upcoming medical students to start looking at how do we provide population health and healthcare to patients who cannot afford care, but bring the care to them in a much more valuable way. I think it's true also there's a lot of opportunity for some kind of relationship between some of our doctors here who are already doing that and the Philippines in learning and teaching them how to extend care in their own rural communities. Any other questions?
So everyone, make sure you've signed in. If you've not, the sign-in sheet is in the front. Thank you so much.
Yes, and thank you, everyone. And if you have any comments, questions, anything that we can do to make things better, please share that with us. Okay. You make the class a better class for sure. You push us to get better people. And I learned as much as you did. So thank you.
Thank you.
We're good. I think we can, yeah, you all can go. Yeah. I'm going. Did everyone sign in?
Yeah.